we always assume that we are a poor country, therefore we must always aspire for some povertarian solution to every problem. Where are we building new cities? Where are our new temples? Where are our new iconic theaters? How long will we worship Queen Victoria? Why can't we build our own buildings to celebrate our own ideas? After all of us will go to New York and go to Statue of Liberty, stand in queue and pay the thing, and somehow think it is not quite a good idea to do it the same thing in our own country. So that is why I'm in favor of that Shivaji statue. Maybe it's an expensive thing, so what?
Sir, because you spoke about things that we could potentially focus on from here on, my question is about, do you see urban governance as one of the areas where you would want to focus, particularly in the sense that strengthening local governments, both financially as well as in terms of their functions, how do you see that?
So, absolutely. I would slightly broaden it, not just urban governance, but the issue of thinking about our cities. And I think this is important because we have thought about, we generally say infrastructure is something we need to invest in India. But in fact, people, the generic problem of infrastructure is no longer the correct way to think about it, because there are parts of our infrastructure that we have dramatically improved over the last 20 odd years. So things that are related to linking different urban centers, we've actually dramatically improved. So look at our airports, most of our, not all, but most of our highways are now pretty decent. The airports are definitely dramatically improved, and in fact, we have operationalized 35 new airports in the last 2 years. So there has been a dramatic improvement in the connectivity between urban hubs. However, the hubs themselves are not necessarily in very good shape, and this is basically what you're saying. Now, there are many things that need to be done. One of them, of course, is that our urban hubs require clear, unified leadership and governance. There are many, many things that need to be done. One, of course, is the lowest level of how we create good leadership, unified leadership at the local level. That is one part of it. But there is a wider issue, because we need to actually begin to rethink our cities and how we want to think about our cities in a very fundamental way. And I'm going to spend a few minutes in talking about the ideas and philosophy of urban design. You may think that why on earth would you care about the philosophy of urban design of all things on earth? This is important because every city is ultimately a reflection of a certain philosophy. Old Delhi, which Shah Jahanabad, is a reflection of a certain medieval feudal view of the city, which was essentially a city. Its center was the imperial household in Red Fort. Its monuments were the, you know, Jama Masjid, which was the imperial mosque, and then various gradations of palaces, going down all the way into hovels. And in fact, Shah Jahanabad, even its height, had lots of slums, because that was the hierarchy on which it was built. Then when New Delhi was built, it was a different vision. It was also an imperial vision, but a different kind of imperial vision. So you had, of course, on Raisina Hill, the reflection of a colonial power. And then you had a gigantic equivalent of a civil lines, right? Now, it is quite interesting, not just was it civil lines, which is a reflection of a colonial worldview, but even when you look at the drawing of civil lines, how it was marked. The large bungalows were called fat white, because they were meant for senior European officials. Then there were smaller ones which were called thin white, which was for junior European officials. And there was other smaller bungalows for thin black, which was for Indian officials who held mid-level positions. But interestingly, there were no spaces or bungalows for fat black, because it was not conceived that there would be senior Indian officials. So this too was a reflection of a certain worldview. Then after independence, when we expanded Delhi, We ended up with creating in places like Arkipuram. Why? This is basically housing for public sector, government officials, etc. This was a reflection, consequently, of Nehruvian socialist view of. So, the city, as you can see, at every stage is reflecting the philosophy of the time. And then from the 90s onwards, we have built Gurgaon, which is a laissez-faire approach to thinking about cities. So, at every stage, the city that we have built is a reflection of the philosophy of the time. However, one of the real problems is, although cities like Gurgaon have emerged, they have not emerged because we consciously thought about them or created plans for them. In fact, far from it, Gurgaon has emerged by defying its master plan. And the reason it could emerge by defying its master plan, because if it actually followed that master plan, Gurgaon as we know it would not have existed. And in fact, all we have would have got, the best we would have got, is yet another Arkipuram. Why? Because although we, our economy, our way of thinking about the world has changed, our urban planning has not. Because we never thought that the philosophy of urban planning may be something that needed upgrading. And so, therefore, we still are captured by this view of the Corbusierian ideal. We still, if you ask anybody on the street and ask which is the best planned city in India, they will still tell you Chandigarh. But Chandigarh is really a subsidy scheme for civil servants. It's not a city at all. And it basically takes up huge amounts of land, houses a tiny number of civil servants. It has produced nothing of cultural or economic value in all these 60 years that it has existed. In fact, Gurgaon, for all its faults, actually pays taxes that keeps Chandigarh running. So, we need to think about our cities completely differently as evolving beings, evolving ecosystems, rather than to think about them as idealized, rigid master plans, which is what we have ended up thinking of them as. This Cartesian kind of worldview, the idea, the Corbusier's idea of cities as machines for living has to be abandoned. We have to begin thinking about them as evolving beings. And this requires us to think in totally different ways. So, I have attempted to put some of these ideas as one of the writers of something called the New Urban Policy Framework, which is in draft and it's online right now as we speak. You can Google it up, read it, give us feedback. But basically, what we are trying to do is to break away from this old rigid master planned view of a city to a much more organic view of the city. And it has many, many interesting implications. For example, we are much more interested in localization, local architecture. We are much more open to continuous evolution of the plan rather than try to make it rigid. All of this is necessary because if you merely have better governance, let's say, but are implementing the wrong urban philosophy, then effectively you will end up with the wrong outcome. See, in the end, governance, structures of governance are a tool to achieve some end, but if the end itself is false, then that's the reason why, you know, even if you try very, very, very hard with Chandigarh, the best you will end up with is Milton Keynes or Canberra or Brasilia. But if you manage Gurgaon better, you'll end up with Singapore. So, I always argue that Singapore is in fact the antithesis of a Chandigarh. It is a completely different, it's a fluid view of where a rigid versus a rigid view. So, it is about managing Gurgaon better.
Okay, so you mentioned judicial reform and administrative reform. What specific
urban reform?
Absolutely, it was another lecture we wanted you to spend time on, but this is a good preview. So, what specifically in judicial reform, other than the upgradation of infrastructure, what about the collegium system? Do you have an opinion on that?
And absolutely.
My second question is around educational reform. Even after, you know, having a, if you like, a right wing or a very nationalist government, we've had very little change in the education sector. We're still studying history from the invaders' perspective, if you like. Any view on that?
Okay, so first question on judicial reform and then on education. Well, yes, absolutely. There are many, many things we need to do. I mean, it's a subject of many law commissions, etc., who have written about this. And there are many things, from procedures to dramatically increasing the number of lawyers we judges we have at various levels. I mean, India has the lowest number of judges per capita in perhaps of any, you know, functioning country in the world. And it's just not of the lawyers. So the other tools also of this legal system are also very, very poorly populated. For example, the number of policemen. India has the lowest number of policemen per capita of any functioning country. In fact, we have fewer policemen than we have NGOs. I'm not saying NGO workers, registered NGOs. So this is one of the issues we need to, so we need to invest into it. We need go to any major city in the world, in the country, and you will find that we are still functioning essentially with the same high court infrastructure that the British left us. You go to Kolkata, the same high court. Where's the new high courts? In a few states, that new states that were created, only there some new buildings were created because they didn't exist to start with. But you know, we are still basically functioning with the same courts system that was left behind with us. And there's no point in blaming the British for it, because you know, we have been now free for 70 odd years. So we need to upgrade these things. We need to put in, for example, the, you know, many routine cases, for example, can basically now be at least half solved by artificial intelligence. It is being used in many parts of the world, nothing new. It's now in fact quite established in places like Singapore, and it's not even very high tech stuff. And so on and so forth. So we need to invest in it at multiple layers. I have just given you some examples of this. But specifically about the collegium system, I think we need to have a debate about this as a national level. Would you say, let's use this same principle in some other branch of the government and see what would happen? How would the their lordships like it if we had decided that a collegium of MPs would decide their successors? Or would you like current and past principal economic advisors to the government of India to decide on who the next principal economic advisor should be? If this principle cannot be applied in other branches of the government, why should it apply to the judiciary itself? Now, I understand the history of it. It had to do with some fears of interference by past governments and so on. But that is no excuse for creating an institutional system that is totally not accountable. I mean, for all the ills that we may blame upon our politicians have to return to the people every 5 years. In a democracy, the power of the ultimately vests in the people. And for whatever it's worth, both the executive indirectly and but the legislator certainly directly goes back to these people for a mandate every 5 years. So what is the equivalent of that with the judiciary? Every other place in the world, there is some form of accountability. In the US, for example, when a judge is appointed, he has to face the Congress. In many other countries, there are other forms. And in the Indian case also, there was used to be, till the collegium system was set up, some sort of a sort of feedback, so to speak, from the people indirectly through the government. Now we have a system that is not. The only thing you really have is is that if somebody does something at a personal level, something not quite right, then you can maybe do something extreme, like maybe what is the term for it? Impeachment. Now, impeachment is not for taking the institution on. The institution of judiciary cannot be impeached. Individuals can be impeached for misconduct on the individual level. But who can we impeach for 34 million cases being stuck? No one. So the institution of judiciary is not held accountable to the people of India in any which way. And this is something we need to have a serious national debate about. Education, sorry, you already had a question. I mean, I fully agree with you that we need to have a serious discussion about our education system. There is the issue, of course, of curriculums and so on history, and you know, I'm very passionate about that and I've given talks about it. But there are some things we need to begin to think differently as well. First of all, it is very embedded in our thinking process about the secondary and primary education that we need to keep expanding it and keep expanding and keep expanding it, because we are not, we don't have enough schools. Oddly enough, we now actually have more than adequate schools in most parts of the country. There may be some parts of the country where we still need to build new schools, but actually, given the sharp decline in birth rates across India, there are parts of the country which have too many schools. So we need to get much more practical and get away from this quantity approach to building schools and begin to think much more seriously about the quality aspects of it. Building ever more schools is actually a waste of time in many states in the country, whether it is in Himachal or Kerala, in probably very shortly in West Bengal. There are many, many places where there are simply not enough kids. So we need to begin to consolidate them and think seriously about quality, not so much about quantity. So that is about school education. As far as university education as well, actually we have actually built a large number of engineering colleges, this, that, the other. Again, we are building too much without thinking through quality. One of the major problems now is inhabiting these institutions with teaching staff. There are huge shortages of professors and faculty in many of these institutions, and we need to begin to, again, quality is an important part of it. Also important to it, and this goes back to our issue about urban issues, we have ended up separating our education system from life in general and our urban landscapes in particular. Now, you may think, why am I talking about this? And I'll show you why this is absolutely critical. Whenever we build an institution, whether it's an IIT, IIM, whatever, we go and catch hold of another 300 acres, build a wall around it, and let whatever will happen inside it. What we are basically doing is separating out our intellectual life from the wider urban landscape. Now, think about the great cities in the world. All of them have great universities embedded in them. Think of Boston without Harvard, MIT, Boston University, etc., etc. Think of London without LSE and King's and University College and so on. Think of New York without NYU or Columbia. And this is how Indian cities were too. I mean, some of our best colleges are not large 300-acre. I went to a great college called Sriram College of Commerce. It's an embedded part of the city. Lady Sriram is an embedded part of the city. St. Xavier's College in Kolkata and the one in Mumbai are embedded in the city. They were a part of the intellectual life of the city. And yet we have separated them out and kept them out. This is actually bad for both the university and the city. There is no benefit to Kanpur from having IIT Kanpur there. There is no benefit to Kharagpur for having IIT Kharagpur there. Why? Because we have walled it off and separated it. Now, why is this bad for the city? Well, obviously, because the city does not benefit from the intellectual churn that the university brings. But it's also bad for the university because it is not interacting with the rest of the world, right? Not just that, there are multiple levels of. So, for example, one of the reasons you have a problem with faculty is because we tend to think of our universities as factory towns, as if the idea is that the professors will go to teach, their wives will sit at home and darn their socks, and the kids will go to the local company school to study. That is not how life works anymore. What do you expect of the social or family lives of the professors? The way we are building our universities out in the boondocks is a waste of time. It is also a waste of time because the way we are going to impart education going forward is going to fundamentally change. Gone are the days where you could educate people till, you know, the first 20 odd years of their lives, and then they spend the next 30, 40 years, go out and use that knowledge they had acquired to do things. This is not how things work anymore. It's all become about lifelong learning. Otherwise, what is happening will happen is that technology will change, but the guy who is actually taking the most important decisions, i.e. the most senior most person in the thing, is the most ignorant about what the current technology is. That world is gone. You now have to go into the world where you and I will go in and out of educational, academic environments, and similarly the academic environment will be continuously imbibing new knowledge from the rest of the world. In this ecosystem of interaction, these walled off institutions are a complete waste of time. So we need to rethink our education in a completely different way. It's not just about upgrading our curriculums in the current framework. The framework itself is rotten, and we need to think about this completely differently. So I would argue one step would be to go to the universities and break their walls. Let people go in and out of them. Build in to these universities, densify them, create commercial establishments inside them. Let there be all kinds of interactions with the rest of the city. And I know if somebody will come here, say, what about security? I'm sorry. There's nothing particularly greatly secure or insecure about the rest of the city. If you're keeping these small, if you want security for particular buildings, you can still do it. But having them completely separated from the rest of the social life is not good for them or good for us.
What's your take on privatizing the government banks? And given the current scenario wherein we had even issues of governance, corporate governance, even the private sector banks, well, ICICI and Yes Bank. So do you think if the government goes on pushing the privatization, it will be easy, it will be difficult to sell the reforms because we had private sector governance issues also? And second question is manufacturing sector, the growth of manufacturing sector by doing things like, you know, flexible labor laws and all. Do you think it will really add value in terms of job creation in an era of, you know, artificial intelligence and automation?
So, absolutely true that we need to do something about our banking system. But there was a greater problem. People tend to think of the governance issue, as you pointed out, as purely a public sector bank problem. It isn't. As we have discovered, there are serious problems of governance even in the private sector. Why? Because there was a general poor quality business culture in the corporate slash financial world. This business culture has, I think, been substantially improved with the recent events with the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court, tightening up of regulations and so on. This is good for both the private sector and the public sector. Now, what do we want to do going forward? Well, I think I would argue that the thinking right now is not to privatize the existing banks, but certainly I think people would say it is fair that having a system where 70% of the banking system is held by the private sector is perhaps not tenable. So a future scenario over the next few years could well be that the private sector plays a much bigger role in risk taking, lending, etc. That I think would be fair. Now, how do we achieve that? Well, I think one way would be, of course, to allow or the private sector itself grows faster. And so that is one way in which this ecosystem would change. Another way could be that some of these private sector, not all, but some maybe at some future date could be considered for privatizing in various ways. I mean, IDBI could be one case in point. And there are many shades of privatization, as you know. And then, you know, you could also have some public sector banks which are competitive growing fast. So I can see the future environment where the private sector plays a bigger role, but I do not think we will end up with a situation where the public sector banking system will not be an important part of the banking system. I think for the foreseeable future, the public sector will continue to play an important role for a variety of reasons. This is not because this government doesn't believe in privatization. Clearly, there are many sectors where we want privatization. But the financial system is a relatively special sector where, for a variety of social and other reasons, the government would like to maintain a foothold and a substantial foothold. So I think the, you know, banking system, the public sector banking will remain for foreseeable future an important part of it, although I agree that the private sector, including foreign banks, will play a ever growing role. But it is not the case that we will wind down the public sector banking system. Manufacturing certainly is a very important thing, and we will be industrializing, so to speak, in an era of post artificial intelligence, robotics, etc., which may pose certain kinds of stresses on us. Reforms will be needed for that. But many of these reforms, as you will be aware, are really needed at the state level, not at the central level. So the idea here is that some form of competitive federalism will really kick in, and you know, some states have already attempted to make some changes, some will make more changes, and so on and so forth. But it's not something I would prefer that it is central government led. It is better that this is more locally driven.
So how we can achieve the high per capita income? So one side, cost competitive and healthy on big companies and all. Another, again, that our level that competitiveness, value creation tech companies like Amazon and other and other corporations. So how these things are not, balanced, and we can achieve the high per capita income?
See, ultimately per capita income is driven by two things: high growth and population. Population growth rate in India is dramatically coming down. Our birth rates are now at replacement rate, which means that we are just about producing enough babies to replace ourselves, and in fact within the next few years it will be below what is needed. So the only reason our population is now growing is because we are living longer. So that is one good thing, and we also are generating reasonably good growth rates. So our per capita incomes are growing. The question, I think what you're asking is not an arithmetic one, but what are the drivers of this growth? Now, one of the issues that we need to take is the fact that something like 40%+ of our population still work, is in some way dependent on agriculture. This agriculture, however, only generates 12% of GDP, and it is shrinking. Now, you will say the solution is to make agriculture grow faster. Now, first of all, it is much more difficult to get agriculture to grow by anything more than 3%. But let us say we manage to get it to grow by 3%. As we have discovered in the last few years, it actually causes its own problems, because with a population that is growing only at less than 1%, agriculture produces more and more food. What are you going to do with it? Maybe you can improve a little bit of the distribution, maybe some people are eating less can eat a little bit more, but generally on a structural basis you cannot consume this food whether you like it or not. And the rest of the world's food prices are even lower than ours. So other than a few segments, exporting this is not an option. So one of the things is, in the end, when we say we have to grow farm incomes, remember we have to think of the rural area as not just in terms of pure agriculture. So a rural person's income has got to be thought of in being a composite between what he gets from his agricultural activities and a lot of non-agricultural activities. Now, the good news is it is already the case in large parts of rural India. In fact, a NABARD survey suggested that even in rural India, something like half of the income comes from non-agricultural activities. So this transition has already happened in some ways. We need to keep building on it, because depending purely on agriculture to generate ever more income is not feasible. So ultimately we will have to think of how to move large parts of our population from doing agriculture related things to doing other things, which may even be in rural areas. But some of it will happen through urbanization and so on. So what are those areas where we can grow? And there is a long list of them, and we can talk about it. But there are many, many areas which we barely exploit. For example, I'll give you the biggest employing sector in the world is, guess what? Guess what is the sector that employs the largest number of places of any sector in the world? Absolutely. Tourism, by some margin. Okay? We are one of the worst exploiters of tourism in the world. We have the largest number of UNESCO World Heritage Sites of any country in the world, but you will be shocked how few people actually visit them. I mean, Angkor Wat gets multiples of more tourists than say Hampi does, and Hampi is a larger site. And so we don't even have regular flights to Hampi. So this is just one example, but there are numerous. I mean, Delhi alone has so many World Heritage sites. So only now, very, very recently, we have finally building, we haven't finished it. Now we are building a visitor museum and other things at Humayun's tomb now. And we have made some improvements now in the Red Fort, which are also in place. But there are literally sites like this scattered all over India. There are literally hundreds of such sites. And yet we are not exploiting them. In fact, ironically, Indians are going abroad in larger numbers than foreigners are coming in. We only get 11 million visitors. Singapore gets 15 million visitors. You know, just to give you the, and many of those 11 million who are visiting are actually Indians visiting their relatives or whatever it is. It's they may be foreign citizens, but they are not tourists in the coming to visit India. They are visiting their relatives. So the point is that we have so heavily underexploited our tourism potential that it's absurd. I mean, we have some of the, I mean, it's only 2 months ago that one of our most beautiful states, Sikkim, got an airport, right? Just 2 months ago. So there are entire states in India which are not exploited. I mean, Maldives has an economy that is entirely run on tourism. The northern half of the same archipelago is Lakshadweep. We have only one hotel there. So this is something we have not spent enough effort on. But there are many, many such sectors. But on the other hand, when we do lend our mind to it, we can do it. For example, civil aviation is a sector that we have now exploded out at such an amazing pace just in the last 2-3 years. As I said, I was mentioning earlier, we have operationalized 35 new airports in the last 2 years. Just think about the number. We are the world's third largest aviation market and the fastest growing one. And we have created it out of thin air. Think back a decade ago to the airports we used to visit. Okay, not so long ago when we used to go from here to say the US, you know, there was a big difference in the airports we took off from and the ones we landed at. Now there's still a big difference, but it's the other way around. Right, when you get on from Mumbai or Delhi and land in JFK, the shock of landing in awful broken down building is on the American side, not on our side. So we are capable of doing this very quickly. Same thing with metro systems. I mean, think about Delhi did not have a metro system a decade ago. Just think about that. Today we have the world's fourth largest metro network, which is only after Beijing, Shanghai and London. And London has taken 1.5 centuries to reach where it has reached now. We have done it in a decade. So when we do set our minds to it, we are quite capable of doing it. Even in manufacturing, we are able to do it. We did not have a cell phone manufacturing industry till 2-3 years ago. Now we have the second I think we are the second largest manufacturer of cell phones in the world or something like that. Yes. Yeah, we have the world's largest producer of LED lighting, for example. We have just begun to expand out into creating our own railway design and research facility, and some brand new rakes are being created. We experimented with one just now, train 18. If it works, we can dramatically expand that as another area of competence. But think about how long it has taken us to get the confidence to do this. Okay, Mumbai is now building an underground railway system. Okay, it will be up and ready in 2 years. But think about how long it has taken us to create this. The other two lines on which Mumbai still basically relies were built in the late 19th century. The train rakes, most of those ones from which you see those fellows hanging out, the last upgrade of them, till we began to introduce the new ones now, the last upgrade of them was in 1920. Go back and look at train designs of 1920, you will see they are exactly the same train designs that we were using till now. It's now, in the last 2 years, that we have begun to introduce air-conditioned trains on Mumbai lines. So a lot of it had to do with our own heads. And it is not that it is not commercially viable. It is entirely commercially viable. Mumbai is not a city of very poor people. People are willing to pay that extra. But we never thought that it would be. So same thing, we never thought of, you know, that we could create this massive train network. We never thought we could create some of the world's best airports. And similarly, nobody thought that within a very short period, and I think I am told that within the next 24 months, Mumbai will begin to get its metro up and running. That's incredible. It will, even 24 months, I'm told, have a brand new airport up in Navi Mumbai. Delhi will have in 36 months a brand new airport in the Agra, Mathura side. Ghewar. So, the fact that we can do it is not that it's not that we can't do it, it's just that we always assumed we couldn't. So, we always assumed that we are a poor country, therefore, we must always aspire for some povertarian solution to every problem. In fact, we made such a big deal out of Jugaad, we wrote books about eulogizing why this is such a great solution to the things. But thankfully, we have finally broken out of that. So, this is the reason, by the way, I am insistent on creating, going for the best wherever we can, even if it's a bit expensive. This is what the Chinese did. When the Chinese began building their bullet train, they were at our per capita income. Today you go, China is connected by this train. They didn't build it today. They began building it when their per capita income was at our level. Never mind what they could afford. They aspired higher. This is why it is important to build the Mumbai Ahmedabad train line. If we can do it one, even if it costs a bit, doesn't matter. We'll do one, then we'll do 100. This is the reason why it's very important we build new iconic buildings. Right? So, when you think of Indian cities today, and I ask you, what are the iconic buildings of those? All of you will say, Kolkata, Victoria Memorial. Mumbai, Victoria Terminus. Arey Baba, Victoria Malika to mar gayi kab se, we are still worshipping her. And yet, we have not built genuine iconic buildings in Indian cities in the last 70 years of being free. Now, more than that, 72 odd years of being free. Because we didn't have a concept. In fact, the only one I can think of off the top of my head is the Vidhan Sauda in Bangalore. That's the only sort of iconic-ish building that we have built since independence. Akshardham. But that's not a public building, to be fair. So the point is, that is what we have. So that is why I'm in favor of that Shivaji statue. Maybe it's an expensive thing. So what? What is the great contributions of our times, of our icon? How long will we worship Queen Victoria? Why can't we build our own buildings to celebrate our own ideas? After all of us will go to New York and go to Statue of Liberty, stand in queue and pay the thing. Then somehow think it is not quite a good idea to do it the same thing in our own country. Why, other than Akshardham and a few others, where are we building new cities? Where are our new temples? Where are our new iconic theaters or whatever it is? I was talking about new high courts. Why not? Why shouldn't these new courts be iconic buildings which express who we are? So, I think this is an important thing, a very important part of increasing per capita income, which you said, is also to aspire to something better.
I had a question about the National Health Protection Scheme, the Ayushman Bharat Scheme. Isn't there a threat that a scheme like that sets up India for an endowment crisis later in the future?
I think this, I'm not an expert on this, so I'm just saying it from a very general way, because I haven't had anything to do with running it. But I think you're right that we don't want to create huge entitlements, which we can't deliver on. But this particular scheme is first of all quite limited. It doesn't give you unlimited care. It gives a limited amount of money to a limited section of the population. And from what I understand, the maths of it sort of works with a little bit of support from the government. So, that is one part of it. The second part of it is that we do need to create a safety net of some sort. If you want a country that is based on risk taking and churn, you also do need to invest in the bottom of the system in some fashion to maintain some level of quality of living. Otherwise, you cannot have a system that is continuously moving around. So it was thought that this would be an interesting intervention, and it is also interesting that it is self-selecting, i.e. it's not handing you money. You have to actually be ill or want an operation or something, then you are getting money, right? So in that sense, it is limited, it's self-selecting in that sense. But yes, it still requires a certain amount of support. But as I said, as it rolls out and evolves, people will have to adjust to what is workable. But as I'm not an expert in it, so let me not mislead you with details which I don't know. Yes.
On the GST system, don't you think there's an inherent weakness with the fact that the states have the ability to add extra cesses, just like Kerala added the after the floods, they added a 1% cess, and with the fact that we have added one more tax slab with for under construction houses of 1%. I know they need to go through the GST council to do all of that, to add extra cesses, but don't you think that's something that, you know, needs more thought on? And another question, so this year we started with a great first quarter with 8% GDP growth. Now it has come down to 6.6%. All the policymakers are trying to push it into the double digit range. Do you think what's stopping us to get there, and by what time frame do we expect to reach there?
So that is true that growth did slow down in the third quarter of this financial year. That's what the latest number shows, 6.6%. Incidentally, we are still the fastest growing economy in the world, even with that. But nevertheless, it is true. And the reason that slowed down, but there were a series of disruptions in that quarter. One of them, that oil prices spiked up. But very importantly, our credit markets froze up because of the ILFS problem having spread through. That situation has more or less unwound for a number of reasons. One is oil prices came down, so that was luck. But the world's liquidity tightening situation that was prevailing at that time has also begun to significantly unwind. We also have a central bank that has now much more realistic view of inflationary pressures and is beginning to lower interest rates and so on. And it was a debate, if you will remember, I was one side of it, where I was making the case that, you know, monetary policy was way too tight. We have now moved into another direction and beginning to ease it. So all of this, these various frictions, so to speak, have begun to unwind. So I am, my feel from the current indicators and from informal discussions is that the growth has sort of bottomed out in that quarter and is gradually picking up. Obviously, there are uncertainties over elections and so on. But by and large, the growth momentum is, if anything, accelerating. We got the latest PMI data yesterday as well, which suggested that orders in the industrial economy are also doing well. So it is, I think things are bottoms up and things are picking up. However, I would argue that it is important to understand that while we want higher growth, we do not want spikes of growth led by downturns. And let me explain this. Quite apart from the fact that growth up and down is uncomfortable if you have cycles and jumps around, there is also a pure arithmetic reason for this. Multiply 4 into 10, you get 40. Multiply 7 into 7, you get 49. Why am I telling you this? Because the average of 4 and 10 is 7. The average of 7 and 7 is also 7. So the average growth rate does not tell you the full story. If you can maintain decent growth rate, but within a small, relatively small range without too much bouncing around, you will ultimately get much higher per capita income than you would get with the same average, but with much more bounce. This is an arithmetic point which is very often forgotten. It's a very simple point. Now, China, for example, has managed to reach much higher levels of per capita income. But if you look at it, mainly what it has done, yes, it got periods of growth of 8, 9, 10% growth. But mostly what it has done is generated 7, 7.5% growth over long periods of time. This is mostly a game of compound interest rates maintained at a decent level without too much bouncing around. So our growth rate of 7% plus, even if we do 7.5% and maintain it for a period of time, you will be amazed. The compounding effect after a few years just goes off. So do not attempt, I would argue, to try for these short bursts of high growth. It's not worth the trouble. This is what the Southeast Asian countries discovered. It's much better to be careful, maintain inflation within that band that we have imposed, make sure our banking system never again goes and does what it did between 2006 and 2012, and basically maintain, which I said, a rule-based system, which has generally encourages risk-taking, but does not otherwise encourage bad behavior. That is, if we just maintain this and keep this going, we are through. Now, talking about specifically about GST, I agree that you do not want a complex system. Over time, it has to be eased up, but you have to allow for the occasional exception. For example, Kerala did go through a natural calamity, so they need resources. So, an exception is made. The idea is that they will unwind it shortly. And of course, we do want to simplify the system, and I think the finance minister had in the past talked about taking the 12% rate and the 18% rate and merging it at some future date. But we will do it over time. Let this current system settle. We have, I think, imposed enough change on everybody. Let this system just work for a little while, then we will simplify it. It's understood that that is the direction you want to go.
The question is, true that we are seeing witnessing a population slow down, but that's in a particular community of a country, a particular population of a country is witnessing that slow down, and the other part, the other population, the other religious sect is actually witnessing a massive growth. Now, because of this, we are actually witnessing a massive demographic collapse of the majority of this nation. Because of this collapse, in another 10 to 15 years, there could be a possibility of the whole foundation of the civilization being, we may see it completely change. How does this, is our current government aware about it? If so, are any plans to curb?
So there are two issues here. One is, what is the rate of demographic change and aggregate, and what is it by community? Now, by community is obviously a different discussion, but from an economic perspective, it is very, very clear that in large parts of the country, we have now seen declines in birth rates to or below the replacement rate. And it is not, it happened first in southern India, but now it is spread large parts of this country. I mean, whether it's Punjab, Himachal, Uttarakhand, in fact, the lowest rates of birth rates in the country are in West Bengal. And for urban West Bengal, just to give you an example, the number of children per woman in urban Bengal, i.e. Calcutta, is only 1.2, which is half of the level required to keep the population stable. Suggesting to me, and given that typically these rates tend to be even lower among the educated population, suggest to me that the Bhadralok population of Bengal will actually become extinct within a generation. Now, these are very large changes in demographics that is absolutely has huge impact. Some of it is necessary because we were growing too fast earlier, but it does mean that we need to begin think about our economics very, very differently. I mentioned earlier about the fact that we may be building too many schools, and there are parts of the country where we need to shut them down. We also need to look at our own budget for social welfare. We have a huge amount dedicated to family planning, whereas in fact we should be shifting that money to infant mortality, much better use of our resources. So this is something we need to, and the next economic survey, hopefully we are hoping to put something in. The issue of differentials between communities is a debate which cannot be for this session because this is most on economic issues, but it is certainly an issue in many parts of the country where not just this but also migration from neighboring countries has been a issue as well. And it is a political issue that this is not an issue that the economists can deal with. Ultimately, this has to be dealt with at a political level. And so that's a debate for another day.
But very important, we have to do.
Fair enough. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.